Heart to Heart on BCTV is supported by Penn State Health Medical Group, Berks Cardiology.
Good evening and thank you. Welcome to Heart to Heart. I'm Dave Spector. With me, Dr. Andy Waxler, our local Simple Country heart doctor, cardiologist.
Look at that jacket.
Tonight we're going to talk about AFib, which is actually atrial fibrillation.
Exactly right.
What is it really?
Well, Dave, thank you. And despite you wearing that ugly jacket, you're still a good guy. This is Philly's country. And that guy was safe at home plate, clearly. Just kidding. Dave's not happy about the call at home plate a couple days ago, but he'll survive. What is atrial fibrillation? Atrial fibrillation is an arrhythmia. What's an arrhythmia? It means that the electrical activity of the heart is out of whack. It's out of sync. It's not right. Now, remember, our hearts are our heart is an electrical organ, right? So just like the lights in the studio, Dave, or any lights in your house, we flip a switch and electricity goes through the wire and tells the lights to turn on. Well, in your body, especially in your heart specifically, we don't have wires, obviously, but we have these little channels where electricity is conducted. And indeed, all heart muscle can conduct electricity. Now, what normally happens? Normally, the two upper chambers of the heart squeeze, called the atria, and then the two bottom chambers, the ventricles, squeeze. So you get upper, lower, upper, lower, upper, lower. In atrial fibrillation, which is a very common arrhythmia, meaning the heart's out of rhythm, the two upper chambers are out of sync. They just don't squeeze properly. I've had patients, usually men, who will literally argue with me. They'll say, "That's a bunch of BS. If my heart was not beating, if my heart was out of sync and it wasn't beating, I wouldn't be here." Well, that's not true. If the two upper chambers, the key here is atrial fibrillation is a problem in the upper chambers. The upper chambers are nice, they're helpful, they contribute a little bit, but where the rubber hits the road is the two lower chambers, especially the left lower chamber. So you can actually live without proper function of your two upper chambers. And in fact, millions of people do. Millions of people in the world have chronic permanent atrial fibrillation. They're in atrial fibrillation all the time. And their two upper chambers really aren't doing much of anything, and they're living just fine. So atrial fibrillation, David, is a common arrhythmia. Arrhythmia means the electrical activity of the heart is out of sync. It is in the upper chambers of the heart. That's why we call it atrial fibrillation. It's in the atria. It doesn't kill you, but there is a big but, though. It can cause a stroke.
Okay. What, if any, symptoms are there?
That's a great question. So the thing about atrial fibrillation is, first of all, it can come and go whenever it darn well pleases. People can be in the normal rhythm 1 minute, and the next minute they're in atrial fibrillation. And people start to think, what was I doing at 7:14 when I went into atrial fibrillation? And the answer is you could have just been reading the newspaper or watching TV or maybe watching the Phillies Braves, that might, or the Eagles, or the Flyers.
Flyers will do it right now.
Yeah, the Flyers will do more than atrial fibrillation. But it can happen any time with no reason. There's no logical reason. People just go into it. And in terms of symptoms, some people get what we call palpitations. Palpitations means the heart just feels like it's racing. So some people say, like, I have patients that literally can say, at 7:14 last night, Waxler, I felt my heart racing. I was watching, Jeopardy, and I looked at the clock, and my heart started racing. So I have a neighbor who's a friend of mine who actually, it's happened to him twice, and it freaks him out. And he knows when he goes into it. So the funny thing is, some people can feel it, and they hate it. It's very frustrating and scary. Many people can't feel it. And we don't really know why that is. We do know that as people get older, they're more likely to have no symptoms. So with age, sometimes you're less likely that you're going to feel it. Other than that, I don't know why some people feel it and some people don't.
So how would, other than going in for tests, why would people even say to you, I think I have AFib, or would they even say that to you? I mean, I'm sure when they see some of these commercials on TV, they're going to say, oh, that's what I've got. Like right. The old days when people would come in from all these medical shows, whatever Tuesday night's show was, that's what they had when they saw their GP on Wednesday morning.
I think that still happens, Dave. I do think that's still the case. So some atrial fibrillation is diagnosed by people having palpitations, you know, having racing heartbeat, going, what the heck's going on? You know, something's not right. Others are diagnosed when they come to see their doctor and their doctor listens. General doctors don't usually get an EKG. An EKG, many of you who are watching the show may have had one. It's where we put stickers on the chest and we push a button and we get this tracing that looks a little bit like the 1906 San Francisco earthquake. You get this sort of seismograph thing and we can read what it means. That's an EKG. We do EKGs on virtually everybody. Just about anybody who comes to see a cardiologist, almost everybody is going to get an EKG. An EKG will tell you right away if they're in AFib.
But like you
but
just
you have
said,
to do one.
If they are in AFib.
Exactly. So but I'll come back to that in a second.
Okay.
So, no, but that's a good point. So, but a family doctor may listen to the heart and hear that it's skipping around. So, right, here's the normal heartbeat. It's kind of like a soldier marching. If I say an Army or a Marine, my Navy buddy will get upset with me. So that's normal. Atrial fibrillation is more like this. Just all over the place. And a good doctor or even a good nurse practitioner or physician's assistant, PA, can listen and usually tell. So, but the answer is, you made a great point, David. David made a great point, and that is, there has to be some luck involved, right? Because I mentioned earlier, atrial fibrillation can come and go. It can come and go whenever it wants. There's usually no rhyme or reason. And, you know, a person can be in atrial fibrillation and then go to the doctor and be in the normal rhythm and then 2 hours later go back in atrial fibrillation. So part of atrial fibrillation is very unfair. Now, my dad died at 37 of something else, so nothing to do with atrial fibrillation. But I was always told life is unfair. So life is a little unfair. Atrial fibrillation is a little unfair because there is a little bit of luck as to whether it's caught or not. It is sneaky. It's very sneaky.
A reminder, we're live tonight. It's Wednesday, April 14th. Started at 7:30. Our number 610-378-0426. And we'll talk about anything heart-related or cardiac-related that you want to talk about. So give us a holler. Back on this AFib.
So one thing that's always bothered me about AFib, and as I mentioned earlier, it's almost never life-threatening, but the bad news is it really puts people at fairly high risk for stroke. And the reason it causes stroke is that the inside of the left upper chamber, the left atrium, looks a little bit like an English muffin. And if you remember the commercial from the 1980s, Nooks and Crannies. And so what happens is, our bodies are set up so that if blood is not flowing, if blood stops flowing, it clots, right? So men, last time you shaved, if you cut yourself shaving, or ladies, last time you shaved your legs, if you cut yourself shaving, what do? Dave's got a beard, he doesn't really shave, but most of us, you hold it for like a minute and presto, it stops bleeding. So the message here is clotting is good, right? Clotting is good because if we didn't clot, we would bleed to death. And there are some conditions like hemophilia where some very unfortunate people have malfunction in their clotting system. So clotting is good to a point.
Clotting is good outside the body.
Right. Clotting inside the body can be a problem. And this is an example of where clotting inside the body is bad because in the left upper chamber, because the chamber's not working, right? This is what's supposed to be happening. You're supposed to squeeze and then relax, squeeze. So the atria and atrial fibrillation are just sort of sitting there vibrating. And what happens is the blood's not swooshing around. And the blood, when it goes into those nooks and crannies, can form blood clots. And then those blood clots can break away and cause strokes. And that's how it happens. And some smart people figured this out way back in like the 50s and 60s. I mean, really smart. When I went to medical school in 1980, we already knew that the treatment is put people on Coumadin. The problem is, do you know what Coumadin was initially invented for?
No.
Rat poison. Coumadin was literally a rat poison in the 40s and 50s. And then somebody figured out that maybe we could use it to thin the blood. And, you know, all jokes aside, millions of lives have been saved by Coumadin. So I'm calling it rat poison, and I'm making fun of it.
But a lot of drugs are poisonous if not handled properly and dosed properly.
Absolutely. Absolutely. It's all about, you know, using the right amount. What do they say? Ketchup and chocolate are both good unless you have too much and then you get a stomachache. So Coumadin is the same way. The point is, though, we've known since the 1980s that you can save lives by preventing, you know, debilitating, if not life-threatening, strokes. And so this is important. So for 50 years we used Coumadin. And then about 7 or 8 years ago, three new drugs came on the market. And I don't work for any of these companies. I don't have anything to gain by mentioning their names, but just for everybody's knowledge, Pradaxa, Xarelto, Eliquis. Pradaxa, Xarelto, Eliquis. We tend to use more of the second than the third, Xarelto and Eliquis, and we as cardiologists have found that they work very well. They thin the blood safely without causing too many bleeds. Remember, everything in life is, you got to weigh the risks and benefits. Putting a person on a blood thinner could cause bleeding problems. Eliquis and Xarelto are very safe, and the likelihood of bleeding is small, and they're very effective. And the beauty is, with Coumadin, people have to get blood tests. So Coumadin's a funny medicine where you literally have to, if you're the patient, you have to go get blood tests periodically, and if your blood test is too low, we increase the Coumadin dose. If
you say periodically, how often do you need to be
that's a good question.
Tests on that? And can it be controlled after a while, or are you always going for these blood tests?
Great question. So for the first few weeks, it's usually about once a week until we kind of find out the right dose for the person, and then it's monthly thereafter. So once a person's on a steady dose, the standard of care is to check it about once a month. You still do need to check it about once a month.
But you're still checking once a month.
Right. And people get frustrated. The other negative of Coumadin, David, is there's a lot of drug-drug interactions and a lot of food interactions. Like, for instance, a lot of green leafy vegetables. You know, we preach to eat like salads and spinach and broccoli and all these healthy stuff. That's actually an antidote for Coumadin. So if a patient has like this big salad with like broccoli and spinach and a lot of lettuce, their Coumadin level will actually go down over the next day or two. The opposite happens if they go on certain antibiotics. Their Coumadin level will go up. There's a lot of examples of patients who have been on Coumadin for years and now they have an infection and they get put on an antibiotic and then 3 days later they're in the ER with a nosebleed. So Coumadin is a great drug. It's saved lives, but it's a pain in the butt. And that's why these new drugs, and again, I don't work for these companies, so please don't say that I'm, you know, inappropriately, pushing these drugs. But they do save lives. And again, that's what we do. We want to prevent things like strokes and death. So atrial fibrillation doesn't usually kill people, but it can cause devastating, and I mean devastating strokes, big strokes, which can kill people or worse, you know, make them, a mess for the rest of their life. So I've always had this thought. Let me talk about the Watchman really fast, and then I'll tell you my thought at the end. So what do you do? I'm going to ask the audience to think about this. I just got through telling you that atrial fibrillation can cause devastatingly large strokes and that thinning the blood will help prevent that, and we have blood thinners. What do you do if the patient just had an intracranial bleed, a head bleed, which can be life-threatening, or let's say the patient's been in the hospital 4 times in the last 3 months with bleeding ulcers and they keep getting transfused? Well, common sense would step in and say, wait a second, what am I going to do here? Because I want to put this patient on a blood thinner so he doesn't have a stroke, but I can't put him on a blood thinner because he'll bleed in his brain, which could kill him, or he may bleed to death from a bleeding ulcer. I mean, until about 7 years ago, that was a problem, David. I've had many difficult conversations with patients saying, you know, you're sort of damned if you do, damned if you don't, because if I put you on a blood thinner, you might bleed to death, and if we don't put you on a blood thinner, you could have a big stroke. And it's my job as a doctor to kind of explain that, and me and the patient and the family sort of have to muddle through and figure out what do we do? And as I said, until about 7 years ago, there really was no good solution. So years ago, when I was a resident doctor, 30 years ago, David, 25 years ago, I used to say, wouldn't that be kind of cool if we could come up with something that would actually prevent blood clots from traveling from the left atrium up to the brain? You know, is there a way you could sort of...
Now, you're only worried about these blood clots forming in the left atrium.
Correct.
Correct? You're not worried about them initially forming anyplace else.
No.
But the concern is them forming there and then going someplace else.
That's right. So okay. In atrial fibrillation, the blood clots form in the left atrium, and then they break off and they travel. And they usually travel north to the brain, although they can go anywhere. People with atrial fibrillation can get blood clots in their arm or their leg. And, you know, I one of my favorite patients, all of a sudden, before he knew he had atrial fibrillation, showed up in the ER with what we call a cold foot. All of a sudden, he had severe pain in his foot, and his foot was cold. He had had a blood clot that had gone down and blocked off part of the circulation to his foot. So the vascular surgeons opened up his foot, and he's now on a blood thinner, and he's done great. The point is that some really, really smart people, figured out a way to prevent blood clots from traveling from the left atrium to the brain and not need you to be on a blood thinner. So it's called the Watchman. And again, I don't have stock in the Watchman either. So if it sounds like I'm talking about proprietary things, I am, but I have no kickback. I'm not getting anything out of this. So please don't, send me a nasty email.
They're
or
not taking you to Puerto Rico for golf. They don't do that anymore.
Those days are those days were gone before I became it. I missed out. Anyway, I missed all that. So I think the 60s and the 70s were a good time to be a doctor, but I missed that. Either way, the point is that this is called the Watchman procedure. It was invented maybe 7 years ago, became FDA approved maybe 6 years ago, 5 years ago, something like that. We've been doing it at, my group goes to both hospitals, but we've been, we've made St. Joe's Hospital a center of excellence for the last, like, I think 5 years. So basically what it is it's this little tiny device that it's probably the size of like a thimble. You know, like when you play Monopoly, that little character that's like a sewing thimble that nobody really uses anymore, I guess.
People still use thimbles now.
They may.
Don't go there.
I don't know.
I know of one. So.
All right. I think I know who that is. So anyway, those little sewing thimble things, it's about that big. And two of my partners, not me, I don't do this. Two of my partners have gotten really, really good. I mean, they've made this a center of excellence, and I'm not kidding. They can go up through the groin, through the vein in the groin, not the artery, but the vein in the groin, and they can actually go across from the right atrium into the left atrium, and they can place this little thimble thing called a Watchman device in this little pocket that God gave us in the left atrium. It's called the left atrial appendage. The left atrial appendage, David, is this little pocket. It's really, I mean, it's like a pocket, literally, that's in the corner of the left atrium. We have no idea why we have it. It's like your appendix or your baby toe. There's certain things on our body that we really don't need.
But they're there.
And they just cause problems. I mean,
right.
The appendix does nothing except get appendicitis. So this left atrial appendage, it really has no purpose except to capture blood clot and then cause strokes. So these two guys in my group can put this little device in through the groin. So it's not surgery. It's through an incision that's like, you know, literally this big, like, you know, I don't know, quarter of an inch or something in the groin. And they can, under X-ray guidance and echo, we use ultrasound and X-ray, they can place this thing in there. It stays put. There's literally less than a 1% chance it's going to break loose. You know, it just doesn't. They can anchor it in there so it doesn't. And they actually do a test where they sort of tug on it to make sure it's in there pretty firm. And then the person has to be on blood thinner for about 45 days until the body sort of heals it. It's got to heal in place. And then the person's off blood thinner for the rest of their life. It's amazing.
How does this keep clots from forming.
Well, it actually, what it does is it plugs up that appendage. It basically gets rid of the appendage.
Well, is that the only place that these clots would have formed? Or?
So that's what I asked. So my concern...
I mean, we were talking about all the nooks and crannies
right.
in the left atrium. No, so it sounds like they're only plugging up one of these nooks.
So, you know, that was my exact concern. When I first heard about this about 7 years ago, I actually said, well, it's great that they can plug up the appendage, but what about the rest of the left atrium? That was my concern. And I said, well, maybe this isn't going to work. Turns out that for whatever reason, the risk of stroke after a Watchman is very similar, almost identical, to the risk of stroke of being on a blood thinner. So we believe that 99%+ of the blood clots actually come from the appendage. So the other little nooks and crannies don't really matter. It's the one big nook and cranny that matters.
So when someone has a stroke or a blood clot that has come from this, there's no way of knowing where in the left atrium this clot originated, other than it's from the left atrium. But other than that, you don't know where in this...
That is correct.
In this, the atrium...
That is correct.
It started.
But a couple things. You're right, but we've got decades of doing tests where we can do ultrasounds of the left atrium. And when you see a blood clot in the left atrium, it's almost always in the appendage. That's the first thing. And then the second thing is the studies show that the Watchman seems to give the same protection as a blood thinner. So... You know,
not really sure why it works, but it does.
It seems to work. And, you know, for that person who's either had a stroke or is at really high risk for stroke, but they have recurrent bleeding internally, and again, common sense says, shoot, I can't not put this person on a blood thinner because he's going to have a big stroke. He had a little one. I'm worried about the big one. But shoot, I can't put him on a blood thinner because he's going to bleed to death. I mean, we used to really, like, you know, scratch our heads. And so I got to say, this has been a godsend. This has really been a nice, nice option. So now I can give the patient a third option. Now, every once in a while, the patient will say, I'm 87 years old. Leave me alone. I don't want to have it. I don't want anything invasive. And I say, I get it. When if I make it, I'll probably say the same thing. But understand, you got three choices. A, be on a blood thinner and be the risk of bleeding. B, stop the blood thinner and be a risk of stroke, or C, have an invasive procedure, you decide. And some of them go, okay, because it is a very minimally invasive procedure. So you're right. A lot of times I have to...
Outpatient or overnight?
Overnight. I wonder if 5 years from now it's not going to be outpatient. The way things trend, it's still overnight because it's still only 5 or 6 years old. And, you know, I think the guys who do it are a little nervous. I wouldn't be surprised. So the answer is it's overnight, but I wouldn't be surprised if someday, by the time you and I need it, David, it might be outpatient.
Okay, so the Watchman is being prescribed when someone has had a stroke or you feel there's a likelihood of a stroke.
From atrial fibrillation.
From atrial fibrillation, and they've got some kind of internal bleeding.
Some we call it a contraindication to blood thinner. They have something about them that says, I can't be on a blood thinner. Now, here's the one minor flaw, and that is they have to be on a blood thinner for 45 days.
Right.
I've actually talked to the two guys in my group who do this, and I said, what if I have a patient who can't be on it for 45 days? And they said, well, that's a problem. They haven't really figured out how to get around that yet. So you have to be able to survive 45 days of a blood thinner to get the Watchman. And I don't really know how to bend that rule. Again, maybe in 5 years, you have to understand in medicine, every couple of years, the companies that design these things come out with the next generation. Maybe in a few years, they'll be able to place a Watchman without blood thinner. We'll have to see. I don't know. You know, who knows? The future is very exciting. I did want to take 1 minute before we run out of time, David, and say the thing about atrial fibrillation, and you alluded to this earlier, is it's hard to diagnose because it's elusive and it can come and go and have no symptoms. I don't have stock in Apple or I don't own an Apple Watch, but things like Fitbits and Apple Watch and all these smart things that people have, if it says your heart's irregular and you might be in atrial fibrillation, call your doctor and go get an EKG. I am convinced that even blood pressure monitors, I have patients that have taken their blood pressure and the thing started blinking saying irregular. Again, I don't have stock in any of these companies, but if you have any of these types of devices and it says your heart is irregular or it even says atrial fibrillation, you don't have to go to the ER. It's not an emergency, but I would say you should see your doctor within a day or two. I would say it's an urgency. And you know, that device may have saved you from a stroke. I have patients, David, who came to me because they sort of accidentally discovered this. And
well,
it's
as we talked about before, it comes and goes.
Right.
So people could have palpitations as they're walking into the office. You could give them a 7-day monitor and nothing shows up. And after the 7 days, as they're walking out, they could have the palpitations
it's
again.
True. I've seen that happen. It's so frustrating. It's so frustrating to us and to the patient. You know, we used to give everybody a 24-hour monitor, and if that didn't work, we would do the 7-day monitor. Well, the insurance industry, who's for the most part a pain in the neck and fights us on everything, some insurance plans will let us go right to a 7-day monitor, and a 7-day monitor at least gives us 7 times more chance of catching it. But still,
this still doesn't mean you're going to catch it.
Only 7 days.
I mean, and you could have a 30-day monitor, and that still doesn't mean you're going to catch it if they've got AFib.
So there is some luck involved. There's no question. You don't want to hear this as a viewer, but it's true. There's a little bit of luck involved. And that's why I believe that these monitoring devices actually may make a dent in this problem. You know what I mean? I think we may get some people that are healthy people that don't even suspect it, that may accidentally find they have a problem.
When you discover this on your watch or your Fitbit or any of these gadgets, which are way beyond me, you don't have to race to the ER, correct?
But make an appointment. See your doc in the next couple days.
Give your GP a call the next day and say, hey.
And, you know, if you don't want to wait to see your doctor, but you're nervous to go to like a full-blown ER, go to an urgent care center. They can do an EKG. You know, so if you say, geez, I want an answer, it's 7 o'clock at night, I don't want to wait and call my doc in the morning, but I really don't want to go to an ER, you know, you could go to an urgent care.
But is the EKG necessarily going to tell you anything?
Well, if you're still in it by the time you get there.
If you're still in it.
Right.
So we've still got that same problem.
There's still the problem.
It comes and goes.
But again, you know, it's worth a shot to try to document it.
If you're that concerned, go to urgent care. We're not telling you don't go or anything like that.
Right.
That's a decision you as a patient have got
to
make.
I just know that a lot of people don't want to go to a big hospital ER. They get intimidated by going to the big hospital, especially with, you know, COVID and all that.
Yeah, but what the doc is telling you is, if your Fitbit says something strange, get in touch with a medical practitioner within a day or two.
That's fair. And if you don't feel good, right, if you're feeling dizzy or something, then you go to the ER.
Well,
so
that's a whole nother thing.
We're
just talking a blinking light or something
that. That's right. Exactly. That's a good point. If you don't feel good, you go to the ER. But if something's blinking, maybe you don't have to go to the ER, but you want to get it checked out. Don't ignore it.
It's not something to ignore, but it's not emergency room time. If you're going to feel better, when you've got that blink on your Apple Watch or your Fitbit or whatever that's telling you something's not right at that moment and you're going to feel better, go to the ER.
I agree.
It's your decision to make on that.
I agree.
And like we've said before, people in the ER aren't upset when you get there with a problem and it turns out it's nothing to worry about.
You are not wasting their time.
No. Hey.
One last thing. Get vaccinated. As of 2 days ago, Pennsylvania opened up to
everybody.
Get vaccinated. The J&J vaccine is on pause. The Pfizer and the Moderna vaccine work great. Get vaccinated.
No big deal. Get it. I've had one. I've got my second dose the end of this week. A pleasure, as always. See you in 2 months. Take care. Folks, thank you very much. Y'all have a good evening.
Go Phillies.
Stay safe.
Go Phils.
Heart to Heart on BCTV is supported by Penn State Health Medical Group, Berks Cardiology.